Let me introduce David Slucki, who is the director of the Australian Center for Jewish Civilization and the Loti Smorgon Associate Professor of Contemporary Jewish Life and Culture at the Monash University. He is a historian who has written widely on Jewish life after the Holocaust, focusing particularly on survivors and their descendants and on representations of the Holocaust. His publications include Sing This at My Funeral, a memoir of fathers and sons, and the International Jewish Labor Bund after 1945 toward a global history. He is the co-editor of Laughter After, Humor and the Holocaust, and In the Shadows of Memory, the Holocaust and the Third Generation. He is currently completing a book manuscript on the significance of the sitcom The Nanny in American culture. And this is what he's going to talk about to us today. I have to say, it's carbon dating myself, but for me, The Nanny is a very important text of culture whose Jewishness I was completely oblivious to when it aired on Polish television, not helped by the fact that later on it had a Polish version that obviously had, obviously for complicated reasons, had no Jewish kind of dimension to it. So I am like, if not for this colloquium series, I would probably buy your upcoming book anyway, but I'm happy to hear about it today. So David, thank you. The floor is yours. Go ahead and present.
Thank you, Marta, so much for inviting me, and thank you, Agnieszka, for your work in making this happen too. And I guess the first thing I'll say is maybe one thing we need to do is collaborate on the reception of The Nanny in Poland. Maybe to think about how I'm actually, when you said that, like that the remake sort of erased the Jewishness, and I'm guessing we're talking late 90s, early 2000s. That's really fascinating to me. But I don't want to get into that too much. Don't want to get in trouble and don't want to get anyone else in trouble. So thank you everyone for coming. What an amazing turnout Tuesday morning at, I guess it's 10 a.m. for you. It's just after 7 p.m. for me on Tuesday evening. So from the future, I can tell you it's a bit breezy and pretty lovely outside. What I want to do today is give you a bit of an overview of my book project, which is, as Marta said, about the significance of The Nanny in American culture. And I like to sort of think about, by extension, global culture, just because of the sort of far reach of American popular culture. And I guess, you know, the fact that there are 57 people in Warsaw on Zoom listening to a talk on The Nanny may be a test to the significance of American culture globally. So I'm going to give an overview of the project, explain some of its interventions, and then what I want to do is show a couple of clips from a couple of episodes and take a bit of a close reading of those. Now, I'm going to do something experimental and ask for a show of hands via the Zoom app. How many of you have seen The Nanny before? Okay. Oh, this is awesome to say. A whole bunch of like thumbs are going up and hands. Okay, so, oh, good, a lot. So this is really nice. You know, this is really nice for me to see that The Nanny has this global reach. I grew up watching The Nanny, and like Maritime, apart from the gray hairs, that also carbon dates me, that was a staple of my childhood. But that's not where I became really, like, I watched it in a time initially when I really wasn't conscious of its significance. To me, it was just a funny sitcom with sort of interesting dialogue and characters that, actually, as a Jewish kid in Australia, that I could relate to. And it might become a little bit clear as I talk why that's the case, that, you know, even though I was kind of far, far away from that context, it still had this kind of significance that I recognized. The other thing I'll just say on that quickly is I was very lucky to grow up in the 1980s and 90s when a slew of Jewish sitcoms hit the TV. And so, you know, it was like as a Jewish kid, it was pretty easy to see myself. And that was pretty unique to that moment. So I'll get a little more into that as I talk. Okay. Oh, and I should also just quickly acknowledge that I'm coming to you here from the land of the Bunwurrung people of the Kulin Nations. And I just want to pay respect to their elders past and present and acknowledge that, you know, I live and work on land, on stolen land that's never been ceded by the sovereign peoples. So that's something we do in Australia to just pay respect to the First Nations people. Okay, now, I just want to give a bit of context to why even write about the nanny, how this came up. This was my pandemic project when the world shut down in March 2020. And I'm not sure how much you're aware, but Melbourne, the city in which I live, was hit particularly hard by lockdowns. Not by COVID per se, but our government took a very aggressive stand on shutting down the city. So we were very much stuck indoors for months at a time with curfews and not allowed to, you know, go more than about 5 kilometers from our house. So, you know, the world locked down and we decided that maybe one thing to do would be to find a TV series to watch as a family. I have a son who was 8 then, just turned 8. And we sort of looked at the options on all the streaming services that we had borrowed passwords to. And we thought the nanny was pretty kind of safe, pretty sweet and easy and like age appropriate for an 8-year-old. And pretty quickly we learned actually it's pretty sexual and very racy. And there's sort of some strange power dynamics between the main characters, and there's some strange gender things going on. But we persisted with it, and the more I watched it, the more it occurred to me, and as a scholar of TV and sitcoms, just how important the nanny was in its moment. Now, the previous project that I'd worked on was an edited volume on Holocaust humor, to which I'd contributed a chapter on Holocaust jokes in sitcoms. So, you know, I hadn't really thought about the nanny much in that context, but watching through it, I realized that, you know, the nanny really set the stage for a lot of the TV series that have come since. So, you know, I was just struck by how funny and how agile Fran Drescher was. You know, a kind of throwback to an old Hollywood star like Lucille Ball or Fanny Brice. You know, she had the sex appeal of Marilyn Monroe. And she just had this like razor sharp New York Jewish wit. And it aged well. You know, we see a lot of art that doesn't age well. Not everything ages well in it, but a lot of it is still funny today. You know, like even in the Me Too era, the nanny holds up very well, and a lot of 90s series don't, even beloved ones. So, you know, Fran Drescher, the creator, crafted this unique character who brought a sensibility that was Jewish, camp, and working class. And so this is kind of what I'm going to explore in today's talk, how the nanny brings us this kind of intersection of Jewishness, queerness, and class consciousness. You know, it hadn't occurred to me before 3 years ago that while I was writing about Seinfeld and Curb Your Enthusiasm, that I should also be talking about the nanny, that it should also be in the same conversation as Friends and Will and Grace and the Golden Girls and Frasier, which all loom much larger. So I just want to give, my dog is knocking on the door, but she's not coming in. I'll bring her in because people like to see her. All right, come on, come on. Okay. So I just want to give a bit of a description of the series because not every hand went up. I had some, my slides are just, I'll show some slides actually. I've got them ready to go. I just haven't shown them. All right. Can you all see my slides? And I'm just going to do that too. Okay. Brilliant. So this is Fran Drescher, the co-creator of The Nanny. And you can see one of the important things here is her fashion. So I'm going to come back to that. Basically, here's what it looked like for us to be sitting there watching The Nanny at, 8:30 at night while the world was shut down. But let's just go to a bit of a description. Now, The Nanny screened on the American network CBS, which was one of the original US TV networks. It screened from 1993 to 99. It ran for 145 episodes over six seasons. So that's a lot of episodes. It's about, what did I work it out? About 70 hours worth of viewing. So if you're thinking of watching it, get started now. I'm not sure what it's streaming on in Poland, but I'm sure it is. Now, The Nanny is the story of a Jewish woman from the Queens neighborhood of Flushing. Her name is Fran Fine, played unforgettably by Fran Drescher, who you see here. She finds herself unwittingly thrust into the role of the nanny of three children of a Broadway producer, Maxwell Sheffield here, and here are the three children. She kind of described it like The Sound of Music, but instead of Julie Andrews, I show up, right? That was her pitch. So, she kind of enters this family. She's a fish out of water. And, the family under her kind of tutelage comes good. She transforms the lives of the children who are navigating the loss of their mother and their adolescence. Maxwell, she sort of helps Maxwell come out of his shell. So she's like a, kind of fairy godmother to the whole family. And the thread that runs through the whole series and which ultimately is resolved is the sexual tension between Fran and Maxwell. The first four seasons in particular, sorry, spoiler alert, the first four seasons in particular very much resolve around the will they, won't they dynamic. They ultimately get married and have babies in a kind of fairy tale ending. Meanwhile, the sharp-tongued butler, Niles, who I'm highlighting there. So let's do that. Yes. Oh, now I've, sorry, my, nope, I can't do that. The sharp-tongued butler, Niles, is at odds with Maxwell's business associate, CC Babcock. And, one of the storylines that runs through is their rivalry, but they also bizarrely kind of end up together. We also come to be acquainted with Fran's family, particularly her parents, Sylvia and Morty. They bring this raucous Jewish sensibility that contrasts with the Sheffields' very repressed, very goyish, right? And I mean that in the nicest possible way, very kind of Gentile and genteel Upper East Side mansion. So the Upper East Side is a very wealthy neighborhood in New York. Ultimately, Fran helps connect Maxwell better to his children and helps the family come out of their shells. Think Mary Poppins. Think, and now The Sound of Music, Nanny has just flown out of my head. The Von Trapps. Think of the Von Trapps. The series fizzles out. Once the sexual tension is resolved, there's kind of less at stake. They admit themselves the last two seasons aren't as important. So I kind of focus on the first part. Now, as I said earlier, The Nanny hasn't received the same accolades as many of its contemporary series, particularly Friends and Seinfeld, which are considered like real landmark TV series. But it does have a large cult following. Just in the past few years, I've been struck by the extent to which the Nanny has been hailed as, you know, a really important series, the subject of long-form profiles in the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times, Vogue magazine, New York magazine. Fran has been dubbed a gay icon, a leftist icon, and a Jewish icon. It's in recent years come onto a streaming platform. It's being adapted as a Broadway musical by Rachel Bloom, who created and starred in Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. In other words, the Nanny's having a moment, which hopefully will mean my book sells many, many copies. I know that it will sell at least 67 copies from the people sitting here today, but it's a while away, so I'll make sure Marta keeps in touch with you. Now, for some historical context, and I gather, are most people here undergraduate students? So it would be fair to assume that the Nanny aired before most of you were born. So to give you some context for the 1990s, and I know my students think it's like ancient history, and, you know, the whole like high-waisted and wide-legged jeans, even though they're coming back in, it's like may as well be the 19th century. But the 1990s, the series coincides very neatly with the presidency of Bill Clinton and the mayoral reign, so the mayor of New York, of Rudolph Giuliani, who we all remember as one of former President Trump's more unhinged advisors. So Giuliani helped to transform the city of New York and make it, you know, more kind of seen to be more safe, more tourist friendly. But what's important here is this is a moment of transition, a moment sort of transitioning out of the Cold War, a moment between the Cold War and 9/11. So it's this kind of in-between period when that notion of the end of history, right, this term coined by Francis Fukuyama, the political scientist, sort of is a prevailing ideology, right, that democracy's won. And we know now that that's kind of silly, that idea. But most sitcoms of that era kind of reflect the fragmentation of American society and the fragmenting of American life. So if you've watched Seinfeld, for example, you know that it has this deeply cynical undertone, that Seinfeld is very much about, ideologically, about people who don't work together, who don't love each other, right? Their philosophy is no hugging, no learning, right? That's the mantra of Seinfeld. But the Nanny, by contrast, offers this utopian vision working against that fracturing. It contrasts with that postmodern cynicism. It's a Cinderella-style fairy tale where ethnic and class backgrounds are no barrier to love, and no barrier to the integrity of the heteronormative nuclear family. So when series like Friends or Seinfeld represent kind of more self-involved single people, although Friends kind of resolves with everyone happily ever after, the Nanny is pushing us the whole way to see something important and integral in the heteronormative family. Okay, my argument is, and this book will be published in the next, if I finish it, in the next year and a half, by Wayne State University Press, I argue that Nanny is a major TV milestone, that it precedes much of what we watch today. Sitcoms that are on TV today owe a great deal to the Nanny, whether they're Jewish themed, whether they're queer themed, or whether they're more broadly ethnic themed. They have the Nanny in their DNA. Sitcoms are famously a conservative genre. Like, since the advent of television in the 1950s, sitcoms have been governed by strict network standards, so lots of censorship. by the demands of advertisers and have typically followed this notion called the LOP, or the least objectionable program. In a way, it's the sort of building of those boundaries that actually allows sitcoms to know what the boundaries are that they can push against. So like scholars of sitcoms are kind of split on whether this form of art is conservative or whether it's boundary breaking or boundary crossing. So The Nanny, even though it's kind of a traditional 22-minute sitcom that has a laugh track and it kind of looks very conventional, it looks very conservative, I argue that it contravenes boundaries in crucial ways that continue to shape television, American Jewish culture, and American culture in the decades since. And so I focus on three particular areas that I've flagged, but I'll touch a bit more on. Oh, here's this nice little thing of, funnily, Seinfeld doesn't end up here. But this, you know, I just found this graphic of like 90s TV shows, like some of you recognize some of this, and some of them cross over the 80s. Teletubbies, Seventh Heaven, Party of Five, I saw somewhere here, Goosebumps, Boy Meets World. I don't know if you guys know all these TV shows. Martin Agnieszka, maybe you confirmed, are these things universal? Okay, good. The Nanny appears twice in this graphic. Without wanting to overanalyze it and not remembering where I got it from, there's something interesting to me about that. But here are the things I focus on, the sort of pillars of my argument. The first is this idea that The Nanny is a Jewish icon. The Nanny reframes what is possible in terms of representing Jews on TV. Now, one thing I always like to put as a caveat is that TV is a very different medium to film. So Jews had been prominent in film. Think Woody Allen, for example, Mel Brooks since the 60s and 70s, right? They're representing very openly Jewish themes, storylines. Jewishness is really prominent in film. And partly that's because of the different ways that TV and film reach their audiences. Films, you know, it's relatively recently that, you know, film distribution kind of reaches all corners of America, let alone the globe. Film was, you know, film is more targeted in terms of its audiences. It's not distributed as widely. It used to be very urban in nature, so like cinemas were in cities. So you're more likely to be targeting an audience that would be comfortable with Jewish characters. But with TV, Jews didn't tend to be on TV because they followed the least objectionable principle. That is, their primary audience wasn't in New York and Los Angeles and Miami. Their primary audience, the kind of lowest common denominator, was in Montana, Louisiana, Ohio, places where people might not have met a Jew or heard of a Jew. And maybe all they knew from Jews was about sort of Christian theological views of who Jews were. So Jews did not tend to feature on TV after the 1950s, when TVs became more widespread throughout America. Originally, like, there was this show called The Goldbergs, not the one that's on TV today, but The Goldbergs, about an immigrant family in the Bronx. But that was when TV was mostly an urban phenomenon. But once it became more national, Jews made way. On screen, off screen, Jews were still very prominent in the TV industry. But more than any show since the 1950s, The Nanny represented Jews outwardly and proudly, and didn't hide it and didn't encode the Jewishness. The Jewishness was out there. They did Jewish rituals. They spoke little snippets of Yiddish in every episode. The second or third episode, the title of the episode is called The Nuchschlep. The Nuchschlep is, a Nuchschlep is in Yiddish for a chaperone. right? This is the second or third episode, and this is not like a common American Yiddishism like oy vey or oy gewalt, right? Like nuchschlep is like quite a niche term. So the introduction of Yiddish into the series kind of signaled a shift in the representation of Jews on American TV. Another factor is the presence of American Jewish food, bagels and lox, tongue sandwiches. I'm gonna show an example of this shortly. Maybe most crucially, maybe not, maybe the next thing will be, but maybe most crucial is the importance of Jewish ritual, something we hadn't really seen even in shows that were starting to introduce a Jewish sensibility. So, for example, when Seinfeld started airing in 1989, so it predated The Nanny by a few years, but it never really showed Jewish rituals. Later, there was an episode with a bar mitzvah. Later, there was an episode that showed Hanukkah party. But it sort of shirked showing Jewishness. And The Nanny takes us inside a synagogue. The Nanny takes us to a Passover Seder. It shows us a Hanukkah ritual. So it puts front and center Jewish ritual in ways other series hadn't done. Maybe as importantly as that, and I'm just noticing something in the chat. Okay. Maybe as importantly, it presents us with what had become by then pretty common stereotypes of Jewish women and to a lesser extent men, and namely the sort of overbearing Jewish mother and the Jewish American princess or Jap, and it subverts those stereotypes. So we get these characters that on the surface look like these stereotypes of Jewish women, which, let's face it, had been typically promulgated by Jewish men, right? Woody Allen, Philip Roth, right? They were the progenitors of this image of, you know, Richard Lewis, Jackie Mason, of the Jewish mother as overbearing, obnoxious, who loved their children so much that they were like suffocate them, but who were also like really selfish and would, you know, hassle their children. Now, you know, the Jap being like the sort of vacuous Jewish woman who all she wants to do is marry a rich man, and, you know, who is like sexually frigid. Now we get these versions of these stereotypes that are lovable. Like those are qualities we like about them, right? Because ultimately the Jewish mother isn't overbearing. I mean, she is overbearing, but what underpins everything is that she loves her daughter and she's the main sort of counsel and guide. They're heroes, right? They go from being kind of antagonists in the worlds of Woody Allen to the heroes in the world of Fran Drescher. You know, these are the characters that make possible the powerful Jewish women we see on TV today. Some of you will have seen Broad City, right? Abby and Alana are direct descendants of Fran Fine. And if you want evidence of that, watch the episode of Broad City where Fran Drescher plays Alana's aunt, right? Literally making that connection that they sort of owe this to them. If any of you have seen The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, Midge is not possible without Fran. Rebecca Bunch from Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, right? Again, that link, it's Rachel Bloom from Crazy Ex-Girlfriend who's writing the Nanny musical, right? They all owe this debt of gratitude. Okay, number two, the Nanny is a queer icon, particularly for gay men, because the Nanny helps to bring a camp sensibility to mainstream audiences. Now, camp is this notion most famously sort of elaborated on by Susan Sontag, the cultural critic, And it's a kind of, you know, historically a coded language or culture among gay men, particularly in an era when it wasn't safe to be out as a gay man. And so camp was, you know, there's this kind of like scholarly debate and discussion about camp and how you actually define it. If any of you know what the Met Gala is, a couple of years ago, the theme of the Met Gala, which is held at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, was camp. So you had all these celebrities dressing in whatever their stylist interpretation of camp was. And it became painfully obvious that they actually didn't understand what camp is. And I don't want to get too much into it. You know, some scholars talk about like there's good camp. So I don't know, like Hairspray by John Waters is good camp. And there's bad camp, like Lady Gaga is an example of like bad camp, where there's kind of this appropriation of camp. You know, one of the problems with actually, this is a sort of critique that I'm making here too, is, you know, historically the idea of camp is that it's subversive. It's not meant for a mainstream audience. It's meant to be a secret language. And Fran Drescher, along with like Madonna's the most famous example, in that era, brings camp into the mainstream. And so, you know, like one thing you get now is like groups of like people going to gay night, like straight people going to gay nightclubs, right? This is partly a consequence of the mainstreaming of camp, that it's like a novelty for straight people. So how does she do this? Well, one of the ways in which she's a queer icon is her outfits. She dresses like a drag queen. She's not a drag queen, but, you know, like this is not how Fran Drescher, I'm sort of pointing to my second screen here and you can't really tell that's what I'm doing because you can just see the screen. But you can see here all these like outrageous outfits. They're kind of like being a drag queen. Not to mention there are a couple of drag queens in the run of the series. There's a Cher drag queen, you know, the singer Cher. But the outfits are like, in the series, they're not, they're all discount, but in real life, they're these designer outfits. They're, you know, fabulous, colorful, loud, right? They sort of like embody some of what is essential to camp. They're kind of they're ridiculous, but knowingly ridiculous, right? They're so outrageous, they're beautiful. She has this very sharp wit and sharp tongue, including a highly sexualized and dirty sense of humor. So, you know, there's that kind of stereotype of like gay men being sassy, right? She like embodies some of that. There's these suggestions that some of the other characters like Niles and Maxwell are coded queer, right? Maxwell is a British Broadway producer. Niles even more so is coded queer. And there's also the normalization of homosexuality, right? So whenever there are storylines or characters that are gay, people are never disgusted by it. Like in Friends is kind of complicated because it kind of normalizes lesbian relationships, but it still like represents gay men as like very disgusting and undesirable and something you don't want to be. Whereas in The Nanny, it's like perfectly normal if someone's gay. It's not something to abhor. Okay, and the third vector through which I look through this is the idea of the nanny as a leftist icon, which kind of is maybe the most surprising of all of these, that there's this class politics embedded in here. You know, despite the kind of glitzy Upper West Side mansion, despite her wardrobe, and despite her aspiration to marry rich, there's actually these like very distinct class consciousness. Like the hero is this working class, no frills working class woman from a very much working class family. And they're the ones that come to shape the rich family. It's the rough and tumble family that are presented as the true American family. Very much tied to Fran's Jewishness and the history of Jews and the left in America. There's this episode where the nanny, where Fran refuses to cross a picket line. That's what you've got a slide of here, and sides with the unions. And that's pretty interesting that, you know, that would be kind of a thread that runs through here. Like the history of Jews and labor activism in the United States is deeply intertwined. And so that runs through the DNA of this. All right, I want to show a clip really quickly because I'm conscious of the time as well. So this is from an episode called Schlepped Away in the first season. The family is scheduled to take a holiday in the Caribbean in the middle of winter, so they're trying to get away from snowy New York for some sunshine. And we pick up the action as they're on their way to the airport.
It's fine, we've passed that same derelict 6 times.
Are we there yet?
I told you to go before we left the house.
I didn't have to go then.
Whatever you do, don't think about rushing rivers or babbling brooks or waterfalls.
I'm singing in the rain.
Is that a gas station?
No.
Hey, where's Ronnie's Slack Shack?
Who cares?
Well, I'm losing all my landmarks. Everything is white from the snow. Oh, I know what we'll do. I know. We'll go to my mother's. From there, I can find my way anywhere.
But couldn't you just pretend you've just left your mother's and are picking me up here on the way to the airport?
Forget it. If you're taking me away for the weekend, the least you can do is pick me up. What kind of a girl do you think I am?
What are you doing here?
Where's your bathroom?
Oh, down the hall. But don't use the rosette soaps. They're just for show.
The Glade is under the sink.
Your father was just in there.
Oh. I have to go, too. Where's your other bathroom?
Oh, it's in the luncheonette on the corner, but they make you order something. I recommend the grilled cheese.
I am so sorry for this intrusion, Mrs. Fine.
Oh, not at all. It's an honor to have you in our house. You couldn't call, tell a person that you're coming? I would have Windexed the couch.
Mrs. Fine, please don't go to any trouble. We're only going to be here for a minute. We're on our way to the airport.
Yeah.
You mean you haven't heard?
Wow.
Heard what?
I just saw it on TV. It's the worst blizzard in 30 years.
Oh, it doesn't look that bad.
Oh, God. Did Kathy Lee come into the studio?
No.
Oh, it's bad.
Yeah. All the airports and the bridges are closed.
What, are you telling me we're actually stuck here?
What about our vacation?
The Caribbean Fair. You never know when there's a revolution, a coup. You'll stay here where you're nice and safe. So, are you hungry? I could make a rump roast. I got a tongue in the freezer.
What did she say?
Well, I am feeling all refreshed and raring to go.
Who's gonna tell her?
Oh, please allow me. The bridges, airports, and weekends with the senator have been shut down due to the blizzard.
Good one, Niles. Let's go. Oh, I get it. You're all in on it, huh? Tell me he's joking.
It won't be so bad. Ma's gonna boil a tongue.
So one of the things here is the nanny is a work of contrasts. Much of the comedy derives from the clash of cultures between Fran and Maxwell, which I think this highlights masterfully. The episode, which we don't see in this clip, starts in the opulent dining room of the Sheffield mansion, where the family eat breakfast together, discuss their plans for vacation, and then they end up in this little apartment where they're kind of overcrowded on top of each other, and they eat, as you saw at the end, like sitting on TV trays, right? Like not at a dining table. Some things that are kind of obvious about the Jewishness here and the class distinctions particularly, right? This is where we get into the class politics. one of the first things we see is plastic on the furniture, right? Plastic coating the furniture. Presumably it's not as nice as whatever the furniture is in the Sheffield's home. And, you know, there's a little visual gag where Maxwell slips on it, showing that he's kind of not used to it. These plastic furniture covers would have resonated not just with Jewish audiences, but with other immigrant groups too, right? Like, it was very typical immigrant thing in the US that, you know, people who brought their furniture from the old country or bought new furniture once they got off their, got on their feet, you know, they would cover it in plastic to preserve it. This was a very common trope. There was a menorah, the Hanukkah menorah on the mantelpiece, which, you know, is kind of an obligatory symbol of Jewishness in pop culture. The food is telling. You know, she has a tongue in the freezer. She's going to boil a tongue, which would have been perfectly normal to a Jewish audience, but completely foreign to these genteel sort of Protestant Americans. Again, it's a story of contrasts. The things they eat mark them as different, and sort of mark a boundary between the refinement of the Sheffields, the sort of Gentile refinement of the Sheffields, and the Jewish boorishness of the Fines. Some other more subtle things, maybe. Brighton, the son, asks where the second bathroom is. They don't have a second bathroom. It's in the luncheonette, the restaurant on the corner, right? That would probably have been completely unthinkable in that sphere, that you would only have one bathroom. They live in a two-bedroom apartment where, as we see, the kitchen is attached. There's nowhere to hide. There is no privacy. The family is on top of one another. This kind of sort of middle-class post-war notion of privacy still doesn't exist in that sphere. And it's prized in a way. It's the thing that brings them together rather than keeping them off in their own corners. When they eat together, it's crowded and in front of the TV, more lack of decorum, lack of manners. The limousine marks this visual bridge, this luxurious marker of wealth that is no match for Mother Nature, and the crowding within the limousine is a kind of sign of what's to come. So I have my window open and there's flying things. Okay, what it suggests is that this ethnic family represents the real America, right? The urban apartment is something audiences might recognize, even suburban audiences, in contrast in the glitzy mansion. So it's the messy emotional family, the family that's in each other's business, that would resonate with American audiences much more than the actual American children, who are kind of depressed and alienated. Do I have time, Marta, to show one more clip, 3 or 4 minutes, and talk about it? All right. So that scene talks to the Jewishness and to the class aspect. This kind of talks to it all. And this is, I argue, one of the greatest scenes of television of all time. Now, some context. This is in season 3, an episode called Stock Tips, where Fran dates a man named Glenn Mitchell, who she understands to be a stockbroker. Very quickly, Glenn befriends Maxwell Sheffield and offers stock tips and accepts Maxwell's invitation to join him at an exclusive men's club. Fran finds out, meanwhile, that Glenn, when he told her he works on Wall Street, when she assumed him to be a stockbroker, it turned out actually he was a hot dog vendor on Wall Street, but didn't care to specify, right? So if someone says to you, I work on Wall Street, ask what they do, because they might turn out that they're a peddler. So Fran races to the men's club to warn Maxwell not to follow his advice. And that's where we enter.
Yes, Mr. Sheffield.
Sorry,
No women allowed.
Well, what is this, the He-Man Woman Haters Club? This is very important. I must speak to Mr. Sheffield. I'm his nanny.
Lady, no woman's ever gotten into this club, and no woman's ever gonna figure out how.
I thought there were no women allowed.
Just the cocktail waitresses, sir.
Shouldn't have thought of that. I go straight to Al Capone.
Excuse me?
I'll have a Brandy Alexander, skim milk, and put it in a parfait glass. Also, that's a lovely shade of blush you're wearing. Now, chicks like to hear that stuff. Oh, yeah, Marianne, cancel my appointment with, the professor. Hey, how you doing?
Hello, Maxwell Sheffield, and you are Mr.?
Ed?
Well, Mr. Ed, this is Mr. Mitchell.
You can call me Glenn.
Oh, well, you can call me Wilbur.
Oh. Glenn here's a stock market whiz.
Oh, a real hot dog, huh?
As a matter of fact, he gave me one hell of a stock tip.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah, yeah. My nanny turned me onto him.
Oh, hey, can I talk to you for a second?
Yeah, sure. And his nanny turned me on, period. She is hot.
Would you excuse us a minute, Glenn?
Well, now, Max, you know, we can wait. We can wait. Go on.
So, Max, what's the story with you and Fran?
What's the story with you and Fran, Max?
I mean, she's a beautiful woman who lives in your house. Haven't you ever been tempted?
Well, to tell you the truth,
Glenn. Here's your Brandy Alexander.
Get out of the way! Mister, what'd you say?
Wrapped around my little finger, you know?
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yes, I say things to her like, but you are so much wiser than I am. Or, the children are so much more comfortable talking to you. You know, rot like that.
Oh, yeah.
I can't believe she hasn't caught on yet.
She will.
Now, Glenn, listen, before I forget, here's that check I promised
you. Oh, no, no business on club premises. I'm a Buddhist.
Well, I don't think this concerns you, Wilbur, old boy.
Well, I think it does, Glenn, old beef.
Now, listen, buddy.
Hey, give me that back.
Gentlemen, please.
Excuse me.
Whoa. Give that to me.
Mr. Sheffield, are you okay?
Wilbur?
No, it's me, Miss Fine.
Oh, thank God. For a moment, I found myself oddly attracted to you. I thought 20 years in musical theater had finally taken its toll on me. What the hell are you doing here dressed like that?
Well, that was the only way that I could get in.
I came to put an end to this thing between you and Glenn.
Would you keep your voice down? It's all right. We live together.
Nothing to see here. Nothing to see here. What a bunch of yenters.
Mr. Sheffield, Glenn is not a stockbroker. You are about to give $100,000 to a man that sells hot dogs.
Hot dogs? How many?
You lied to me.
He lied to both of us. What, were you using me to get to him?
I didn't even know you.
Oh, so I suppose that afternoon in the Hamptons meant nothing to you?
Okay, so I really love that the whole episode, and I wish I could show the whole thing to you, but it captures the boundary crossing that sits at the heart of the Nanny. I think for those of you who are kind of sitcom historians, you'll know the iconic scene of Lucille Ball stomping grapes. And I think this should be like considered in the pantheon of classic TV scenes. Fran crosses into a hidden world that she has no access to as a woman, presumably as a Jew and as a worker, right? And if we're going to take this analogy further, as a queer coded person, she crosses the boundary with regard to race, ethnicity, class, gender, sexuality. They're all intertwined. It follows in the footsteps of iconic Jewish performers like Molly Picon and Barbara Streisand, who don drag to fool the hapless men in power. She's not in the, like they are seeking access to a forbidden Jewish world, but to the whitest American institution, the men's club. Now, much of the scene kind of that alludes to the fluidity of gender and sexuality, not only because of the cross-dressing and the drag, but also because of what happens with her interactions with Maxwell and Glenn and their attraction to her and all the innuendo about like the weekend in the Hamptons, right? It's sort of smashing any boundaries between the kind of heteronormative expectations that we have. And although, you know, she totally disrupts the space as a Jewish drag queen, as a working class Jewish drag king, she completely upends that space. It's not only about the exclusion of women, but about the exclusion of Jews and about the wealth divide. So it touches on all these points. And I'll just conclude really quickly. The Nanny is not a perfect series. You know, there's a through line of fat jokes around Sylvia that don't hold up so well. But in these areas, it really is a milestone, and it shapes American popular culture in ways that I think we don't quite appreciate. So I hope that my work will help to kind of recast how we think of it in our imagination. Okay, I went on a little longer than I hoped, so I hope you'll indulge me. And yeah, I'd love to have a chat and give you the chance to ask some questions as well.
Thank you. I mean, I had fun, but that was, I think, assumed from the get-go. One thing that I would probably have to rewatch the Polish version of The Nanny to confirm, but my intuition is that not just the Jewishness, but definitely the camp is lost in the Polish version. Though here, I don't know, maybe I'm too prejudiced, so I have to rewatch it. I wanted to.
When you say that, do you mean like because of present day politics, you assume that that was the case?
No, I think that the camp that was present in the 2000s in Poland, I don't think it would enter into a mainstream TV show in the same way. And I don't know how fluent were the people doing the Polish adaptation in reading the camp of the original.
Gotcha.
And translate it. And because this notion of least objectionable programming, I think works not only for the American sitcom, but would probably be true for most sitcoms created, right? It is this, especially for kind of network television. So that's my intuition. But again, I would have to look it up. I think that the class distinction, kind of the cultural clash, based on class, is the one that I see kind of most coming to the fore. But I wanted to actually ask about two things that you said, and I think they might be separate questions. You can lump them together. I would like you to speak a bit more about the fat phobia of this sitcom, because I think it is an interesting trope in terms of Jewish American women's representation, that it's a through line, kind of the obsession You've mentioned the Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, but like a lot of the kind of Jewish sitcom characters are obsessed with their skinniness, or they have parents, overbearing mothers or others, who are obsessed with their skinniness. At the same time, where the discourse of a lot of, especially post-Holocaust survivors and descendants, is all about feeding, right? It's the kind of a culture of like, we've survived hunger, you don't wanna waste food, you need to finish whatever you have on your plate. So I like this tension, and I'm wondering the degree to which this is part of the assimilation process of these young women into waspishness, this thinness. So this is one thing what I would love to hear you comment on. And then another thing that I would be interested to hear, and you kind of answered that question with like follow up to your discussion of the scenes, but I'm wondering if simple depiction of a working class character is enough to say that the show as such has, let's say, a leftist potential. I mean, yes, I'm sure we can read it into the text, but I think I need more persuasion in terms of saying that it has a leftist agenda, because I'm sold on the Jewish and I'm sold on the camp and queer, especially given Fran Drescher's personal story, right? Her husband, who was, I think, co-writer or co-producer on that show later on in life, came out as gay, right? And she
in the later run of the series, he came out as gay.
Yeah, exactly. And then now I think they have a show where like that's the topic, right? It's the Fran Drescher plays herself kind of with a wife whose husband of many years just came out as gay. So I'm wondering if kind of you can speak to both of these questions.
Yes. Okay. So fat phobia is a really, I mean, it's a great question. And, you know, it's funny, like, and maybe it says more about me, but it's just, I read this article about it a couple of years ago, like an online zine or something. And I was like, yes, that seems like the most obvious thing in the world, actually. And I did not read it into it. And you know, it's one of those things, once you read it, you see it everywhere, like every episode, this fear that Fan will become fat like her mother, right? Like that's the line that runs through it. And, you know, when you sort of start to see it, it's quite shocking.
Sorry, actually. And also, I'm sorry, because it's not just that. And I'm thinking of Miles constantly commenting on whatever the wasp
is. Oh, Cece, yeah.
Cece's kind of gaining weight, and the actress, I think, became pregnant at some point. So she did like grow.
She literally gained weight, yes, with a baby.
So there was quite a lot of that on that level, kind of confirming that whiteness, right, for women.
And part of that was this, like, part of their explanation for that is they were trying to like hide her pregnancy. So they were looking for ways to like work around it, but that's obviously a ham-fisted way to do it. I really like your reading of it, though, that it's part of a narrative of assimilation, the obsession with thinness. Because you're right, like there's so much about these tropes that are about fitting in and looking all American, right? Like the most obvious one is the nose job. A lot of you will have seen Friends, and you know, one of the running jokes in Friends is Rachel's nose job. And that's one of the ways we know that she's Jewish, the character, right? Like my students tend to be baffled when I show them an episode of the Friends and they say, what's Jewish about that? But the ones who've seen Friends know that they make a running joke about a nose job. And that's a kind of an identifier, right? Like this trope of young women getting a nose job as like a sweet 16th birthday present from their parents. So similarly, this obsession with thinness, I think you're right. Like, I think it's part of that, of kind of fitting in this like world of like beautiful waspy women with straight hair, right? Not curl. Like that's the other thing about Fran. She has the big bouffant, big black bouffant, not straight blonde hair. So yes, that is to say, I agree with you, and I think that's a really important thing to bring up, and especially when thinking about like the Jewish women aspect, right? It's not just about women, but there's something that's like feeds into this question of the Jewishness, why there's that obsession with weight gain. But at the same time, like, it's a running joke about Sylvia being gluttonous, right? She's always like eating, and we, you know, we're meant to laugh at that. So we're both meant to laugh at Sylvia's weight and Fran's fear of gaining weight.
And I mean, it's interesting what you say about Friends, because like one of the criticism hurled at the TV show recently, I think by Sarah Silverman in general, right, is that all of these Jewish women of sitcoms who are very veiled, right, like that the characters of, yeah, Friends, I mean, they are, a lot of them are Jewish, but they're not represented in that way. It's hinted at through the nose job or some like small details, but not to the extent that, for example, Fran Fine is Jewish.
Well, right? Yeah, and that's part of my argument. But actually, Sarah Silverman goes a step further and says, like, not only are they not very what I call Jewy, but I don't recommend people use that word. it's not just that they're not very Jewish, but their Jewish characters are not played by Jewish actors. Friends is really interesting because the two Jewish women are played by non-Jews. The non-Jewish woman is played by a Jewish actor. So Phoebe is not Jewish, but God, what's her name? Just escaped me. I'm like...
Monica?
Phoebe, the actor who plays Phoebe. Oh. Lisa Kudrow. Lisa Kudrow is Jewish. So this kind of this irony here, right? Like, who gets to play Jewish roles? Like, who looks Jewish, in other words? That's a big part of it. So you do get these sitcoms like The Nanny, where Jewish creators cast Jewish women in those roles or cast themselves as Jewish women. So Broad City is another example, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. But oftentimes when it's non-Jewish creators like Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, they cast non-Jewish actors in the role. One other thing I want to say about this is Fran Fine, like, Fran Drescher was anorexic through part of the run of the series, so she was like very skinny. I always like Friends as a point of contrast because it's the juggernaut in this genre. The women in Friends were the kind of ideal of sexual desire. Like, Rachel is kind of like what people aspired to be in the 90s. You know, that was like the haircut was the Rachel. Fran Fine, in the narrative of Friends, whether in the reality or not, but in the narrative, is seen as like curvy and like more full figured. And when you look at her alongside the body types of the Friends ideal, it's like she's not that different, actually. But the running joke is, and maybe it's like meant to be an irony, right, that she's actually not very full figured, but it's meant to be seen as a kind of contrast with like the kind of very thin ideal of Friends. I think you're right. Like, this, I don't talk about it a lot, but maybe I need to talk about it more. The role of this discourse around weight.
Feel free to footnote me.
I will. You'll be in my acknowledgements.
So maybe I can ask a question while others are thinking about their questions, because I had a friend who contacted me before your lecture asking if this is going to be recorded, because he's in the States and his husband would like to watch it, because they had a discussion. His husband is Italian, and his husband was super surprised that that Nanny is Jewish, because as a kid growing up in Italy, he was watching Italian, well, it wasn't Italian version of Nanny. It was like Nanny heavily dubbed and heavily edited for Italian audiences. And I checked it, and apparently Nanny in the kind of Italian version is Roman Catholic. And like
Sicilian, like, or something. She's Sicilian, yeah.
And I was so surprised at this, that you know, because it's not even a version of Nanny. Like, the Polish version is actually, we have a Polish cast, and you know, it's been Polonized in a sense. But with the Italian example, it's not even a new version. It's just dubbing and you know, changing names and change, but also changing so many details, which are so crucial. So I was kind of wondering if you've come across this in your research, if you kind of
Yeah.
like what's going on here, like
There is literally a book called I Didn't Know Fran Drescher Was Jewish, or the sorry, I Didn't Know the Nanny Was Jewish, and it is literally about it being dubbed into Italian. So there's a book about this, not and it's actually not just about the nanny. There's a few series, but it's about like Italian translations of US sitcoms and the fact that exactly as you described, like the translation isn't just translating the words, but actually the storyline and the themes to make it legible. I mean, there's a kind of pragmatic reason, and that is that like this the thing about the boroughs in New York, like Queens and Manhattan, wouldn't make sense to an Italian audience. So the Jewish and the WASPiness wouldn't make sense to an audience. So they translate it again. They don't just translate the word, but they sort of translate the whole context so it makes sense to that audience. And that's quite common. Like it happened, there's a bit of scholarship about this, funnily, about the nanny specifically and about other versions. So I think in Argentina, there was like not just a Spanish language version, but an Argentine translation that is like specifically for that context and kind of like. Because it could be anywhere, right? Like there are the external shots of New York, but it's filmed in a studio a lot in Los Angeles. And it's really just most of the action takes place in the mansion. So that doesn't have to be the Upper East Side of New York City. So you can easily kind of rewrite it as you go, and map on these different identities to still capture the tension that exists and still capture the contrast. So it might be like a Sicilian nanny with a Northern Italian family, and you still get the essence of it. Like, to me, it's a really interesting question because one thing it shows is at the root of this all, there's a universality to this story and to the fairy tale, right? Like, ultimately, we're talking about a fairy tale, a fan this fantasy, like Cinderella. I mean, not like Cinderella because. You know, the evil stepsisters like cut off their feet basically. But there is this like fantastical fairy tale element with a happy ending. You know, this is a universal thing. And so you can sort of take that and drop it in any context and change the names, and it makes sense. And I think that's like one of the really interesting things about the series. I suspect the Italian version, like Marta, you were describing with the Polish version, you probably lose some of what makes it innovative in the English-speaking context, and particularly the American context, which I think is the representation of ethnicity. You know, because it's not only these Jewish sitcoms that come after, it's Everybody Loves Raymond. Another Queens sitcom. They went to the same high school in the same class, actually, Fran Drescher and Ray Romano. You get King of Queens, right? Fran used to refer, she thinks they stole the name from her because she always called herself the Queen of Queens. You know, pretty much any representation of an immigrant or ethnic group after the 1990s also has its DNA in the nanny. In the like model minority sense, in a way, you know, they're like thoroughly American. But you know, that some of that nuance gets lost. But some of it, like some of what's at the heart, is universal. And so you can easily translate it to Italian or Spanish or whatever language, Polish.
Sorry, I
Oh, sorry, Marta, I forgot to answer your other question about,
no, that's totally fine.
About why she's a leftist icon, yeah. Or why there's like a working class aspect here. I mean, I do think that, I do think there's this thing about the working class character constantly outwitting the wealthy and powerful, and kind of like, what do spies do? They
infiltrate.
Infiltrate. Thank you. I had to come to Poland to find my English words. She kind of infiltrates this family and turns them into this, like, in Yiddish we say Hamish, right? Like warm, homely family. She turns them Jewish in a way, not because of the ritual, but because of the importance of family and looking out for one another and having some humility. She changes the family. She brings her sort of working class values into the mansion. And that prevails. So even though she marries into one and becomes a Sheffield, and again, I kind of discount the last two seasons where the sexual tension resolves itself, because that's a network-driven decision. Like, that doesn't come from the creators. That's basically, in other words, a commercial decision. But in those first 3 to 4 seasons, there's very much this, like, classic trope of the powerless outwits the powerful. You can, like, even trace this stuff back to, like, Jewish folk tales from medieval Poland, where, like, the Jews outwit the priests and the Polish townspeople or whatever. So, I mean, I don't think there's a direct line there, but there is this kind of parallel where the powerless kind of outwit the powerful. And in that way, I think, like, it's elevating the role of the working class character. And I argue that it's real, like, Queens is the real America, not Manhattan. You know, that's kind of the pitch. What's the real America here? You know, like, Americans use the term middle class to really describe actually working class people. And, you know, like, you see their home, it's like very modest. And it, like, exemplifies in some ways the American dream. But, you know, Fran worked in a bridal shop and then went to work as a nanny. Now, I know I'm, like, dragging on a bit, but one of the really interesting things in here is, and this is where it really is in the realm of fantasies, even when this screened, most nannies that you would have seen in the park in New York would have been Black or Dominican or Puerto Rican, right? You don't get many white Jewish nannies from Queens in that context. So it really is a fairy tale in that way. It doesn't necessarily reflect the reality of New York. At the same time, though, like, you know, it shows that there is this thing as a Jewish working class still, even when Jews have this kind of, there's this image of Jews as wealthy. Like, the reality is there's lots of Jewish poverty nonetheless, and lots of Jewish workers. So I think it's sort of, there is, like, a reality there. There's also, like, a fantasy that doesn't reflect reality.
Okay, great. Thank you for that. I'm wondering, obviously, if for a Polish viewer, the Fine's house would be read as modest, but that's it's probably a conversation we can have at a different time. We need to, unfortunately, finish because our students are leaving because they have classes in 10 minutes.
Oh, go to class, yes.
That's why the big exodus, I think, was of people worried that they might not get to class. And I appreciate those of you who have stayed. I'm sure that if you have follow-up questions or any comments, we can share David's email and
yes, I'm sure, please can email me and be in touch. I'm gonna come to Poland sometime in the next year or so I'm gonna come knocking on your doors.
Yes, definitely. We would love to. We would love to have you again, maybe in person. So thank you for doing this. Thank you for everyone who managed to join us on this unusual time and format.
Thank you. And you should all come to Australia. Come study with us. Come do study abroad at Monash. Come do a master's or a PhD with us. We would love to have you.
You've just discovered, they just discovered a new spider in Australia. I don't think I am coming, at least.
No, Melbourne's fine. Melbourne's fine.
I do not believe anything you say. Okay, so thank you. I will abruptly end this Zoom, but it was lovely to meet you, David. I am hoping that you will visit us in person in Poland. And I'm hoping to see our students and faculty who have joined us for today come to our upcoming shows. And thank you, Agnieszka, also for helping with the technical.
Thank you, David. Thank you, Martin.
Okay.
Thanks, bye. Everyone.